from Rosendahl, chairman of Blender Foundation, or there's no major of Blender. I put mostly emails and other stuff, and organizing Blender conference, of course. Now, so once in a while, I have a weird dream, right? That's once or twice per year. And in my dream, I wake up, and I think, shit, Blender conference, Blender conference. I've forgotten Blender conference. So I jump on my bike, and I go to some place, which doesn't look at all like this. Big and hundreds of people walking around having fun. And they say, Tom, where were you? The Blender conference is almost over. I said, what? I missed the Blender conference. So yeah, that's the, even after 17 years of doing Blender conferences, I'm still nervous. For me, this is a highlight of the year. But we want to make it better, more fun, and bigger every year. We do our best. And I hope you will tremendously enjoy this next 3 days. So 17 years ago, right, some people might remember, I'm the guy on the right, by the way. 17 years ago, we had the official launch of Blender as open source project. And they took a picture of that moment. This is the moment when the first CVS, we called it back then, the versioning system, the first CVS commit of the source code was online on October 13, 2002. This is a little bit of tradition why Blender conferences are held in October. To memorize like the anniversary of Blender being an open source project. People might remember this place. We've been there for many years. It was 100, 120 people, and then it was full, but we were at the top floor of this building. So I was very happy that we could finally move since 2009 to the body. And this is actually the 10th conference that we are doing in the body. So this feels like home here. I know it's a bit too small. Yes, you, body. I said hi to the guys in the salon. Hey, salon, can I hear you? I don't know, it's quite some roof here. So not everybody fits in. I'm so sorry about that. But then the community, we are one big family, but we can sit on each other's lap and be a little bit closer and try to squeeze in everyone to have a fantastic conference. So usually I start a little warming up because I would like to know who is my audience. Every time I do this always since 2002, asking the audience some questions. It's very boring, but I enjoy it a lot. So the first question is, of course, what is the country you are from? And I always try to remember the 180 countries in Europe, but I forget always half of them. So this time I'm going over the top 20 countries that visit Blender.org. And what you see in this slide is the amount of visitors of 4 weeks at the Blender website. It's 1 million people. And at number 20 we have Ukraine. Are there people from the Ukraine in the audience? No. Okay. Turkey, we have people from Turkey? Yes, awesome. Number 18 is the Philippines. Imagine, there's a big film industry in the Philippines, I know, but it's far away, so it's not Philippines here. And then 17, yes, the Netherlands. Dutch people, where are you? Only a few. I think all the Dutch people are sitting in the other room. Mexico, where are the Mexicans? We have a Mexican here today? Not here in this room. Australia. Yeah. Australia, you! Poland, number 15, Poland. Yes, there. There, fantastic, welcome. China, are there people from China? Would be a miracle, fantastic. Okay, Spain, yes, Spain, where is Spain? That's Spain. Italy, woo! 11 points for Italy, woo! So, next, Indonesia, look at that, number 10. A visitor from Indonesia? Canada, I know there's at least one there, yes? Japan, visitors from Japan? Then, France, La France. French, yes. I think If you look at the amount of studios who are switching to Blender, France is really number one. A lot of professionals are with studios using Blender for all kinds of productions. Russia. Russia, come on down more Russians. Brazil, there are the Brazilians. Maybe next door. I know there's speakers from Brazil, so there must be a United Kingdom, number four. Ah, look at that, UK. Germany. Wow. Well, it's very close, I know. And then surprising number two is India. Can you imagine? India, you! And the greatest country on earth, United States. Where are the United States? Welcome. Good. So, next question is, what do you guys do with Blender? What is your profession? So I would like to see, are there scientists here? People who do science at university or so? Can I see scientists? Yeah, scientists? Scientists? Good. University teachers? Are there people who are still student? University student, high school, or college? Okay. Are there people who are working in education or doing training? That is good. Then I want to like to see architects. Other architects. There's one, two, three, four. Okay, cool. Or designer in general, industrial design, graphics design, anything that you can call yourself a designer. Yeah. And then for people who work in the film industry in one way or the other. Yeah, look at that, okay? But then I want to see animators. Where are the animators? One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. Excellent. You all have to talk to me or to Chelsea there. Oops, because we really like animators. And they are very needed for projects we're doing in Amsterdam. So if you know how to animate, talk to us. Modeling. Who uses Blender for modeling? Or who thinks he's a modeler? Yes? Okay. Or visual effects. Visual effect people. You are like everything there in the back. And then the texturing, lighting, rendering people. That's super important. Yeah? Good. Excellent. Then who's in the games business? Games. Not that many. So we have to work on that. Yeah. Oh, we have Eevee, come on, this is fantastic for game development. So, but who would be calling himself a game developer or a game artist? Mix of it, both of it. Yeah. Then the most important category is developers. So who thinks he is a developer? What? But even who is currently working on Blender? Where are the Blender guys, the Blender developers? Come on. You have to see all the Blender developers. Yeah, that one too. Put up your hands. Blender developers are all available during the whole conference to be harassed, poked, kicked, talked to, or you give them drinks or beer or you do whatever. But Blender developers are the people who are making Blender, so you have to be good friends with them, right? Good. Yeah, so the most important question, what I want to know every year, is how it's about the selection in Blender. So who's selecting with left mouse? The left mouse people selecting with left mouse. Can I see hands? So few? Who's selecting with right mouse? No way! I think all the left mouse people are in the other room. So yeah, and then we do a little countdown. So for whom is this the first conference? The first conference, the virgins. Yes, all right, good. And I'm going to count down because it's all the way to 17. So get the picture in your brain. How many conferences did you have? Two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, not getting lonely, 10 or more conferences. Yeah? Wow. So where is 11, 12, 13, you don't know, 14, 15, 16? Is there one with 17 conferences? That's one. Wow. Amy.
So I'm going to talk about last year. What did we do last year? Well, we almost did a release, right? Actually, 2.79 was done in September last year, but we did two updates this year, February and March. And 2.79 is still Blender stable release. A couple of features to highlight is, of course, we had denoising in the renderer, saving lots and lots of render time. This is the Filmic Blender. This is the way to get your color management done properly, so you get your pictures working. And we work, for example, on OpenCL to have graphics cards that are not NVIDIA cards that will work with Blender well. And what you see in the diagram is that lower means better, and the blue graphs were the AMD graphics cards. But, yeah, everybody, this is where we're looking forward to, and this is the thing we were working on for most of the years, Blender 2.8. And Blender 2.8 had a whole long list of features, and I think I already talked about this for like 2 or 3 years, that we were going to do it. I can currently say that we have half of this, at least, right? The top features are on the list, up to the grease pencil integration, they're more or less final. And then there are topics we are still working on, like the asset management, the workflow for commercial projects, even though we have UDIM, OpenShipDiff working, Alembic is working, OpenVDB is still in progress, and the Blender 101 project. So, what happened last year after the Blender conference, I noticed that this whole progress in Blender 2.8 was still slow. And I thought, if you move on with this speed, it will take us another 2 years or so to get there. And that's when I thought of doing a community campaign, a public campaign, to get all the Blender developers who are working on Blender, who work on Blender 2.8, to get them together for 3 months and do not a sprint, but what we call the code quest. So these are the people we invited in. Most of them were there for 3 months, some of them for a shorter period. And thanks to you guys, what you were all massively buying, this little rocket token, we sold 3,200 of them in like no time. And this helped us getting the funding. And of course, thanks to companies who helped us with contributions. Together, we could fly them all in. Everybody had an apartment. People even had private apartments for 3 months in Amsterdam. They were completely pampered and lots of love. And as a result, Blender 2.8 got a massive sprint forward. Not only that, we were lucky also that the Blender Institute was moving to a bigger place. So we now have a real office, a building where we can do things, which, by the way, now has a logo on the front. Sunday at 12 o'clock, there is an open house. Everybody can come in and visit and inspect what we are doing here. So yeah, 2.8, one of my personal highlights was that we were making lots and lots and lots of little videos. You could follow the progress of 2.8, not only via commits or code or docs or whatever developers are doing together. We had Pablo in the studio making every few days a little update on what was going on in the code quest. If you haven't seen those videos...
Yeah, Willem, I heard there's new icons in the toolbar.
Yes, the icons are actually done as real 3D objects. And here's our proof. Because here we have a scan of Campbell Barton.
This is a Campbell.
This is a Campbell.
You had a Chief A Campbell.
Exactly. And then we've taken this scan and inserted it as one of our icons. So in the toolbar, as you can see, now we have 3 Campbells.
Come on.
What's going on, guys?
I heard.
We did a break today.
No, we are like something is gonna break the internet. It's Eevee going NPR.
That's it, guys. It's now in. And so basically, what it does is.
It's a new node.
It's a new node, and it converts the output of a BSDF node, and converts it directly to a color that you can work with. So the basic workflow is to put the color back into an emission node so you can see the color. So here it's a simple pass-through setup, but you can use this
online if you watch it. I heard there's like a celebration going on over here.
What is that? Ooh,
fireworks. Is this what? Blender? Blendini? Where is it? So, hi Jax. Animation notes.
Animation notes.
Yes. So you're here visiting at the Blender Animation Studio for a week already, working on
particle nodes and interactive mode stuff and everything nodes and.
Good. So what is the status of 2.8? Tomorrow I have several of the developers together. We do a little talk of 1 hour about what is currently going on with 2.8, what is the status. We did some alpha releases. We wanted to do a beta release at the Blender conference, but we also have to do a Blender conference, so we do it after the Blender conference. Is it more sensible? And in a couple of weeks, in November somewhere, there will be an official beta. And beta means that 2.8 then is feature complete. So what we define to be the features of Blender 2.8 will be complete. Should work, but not finished yet. There will be a roadmap article on the code blog. I think it was posted yesterday, but I had no time to check on it. If it's not, then it's being posted right now. Another project we did was a benchmark. It was really time to have an open source public benchmark where people can look inside and see what's going on here, what's being tested. And Blender is, of course, perfect for that. You can go to the open data website, opendata.blender.org, to download the benchmark, which is like a Blender 2.8 wrapper around 2.79, which runs in a nice window, a couple of tests. And optionally, you can send all the results to the Blender website, which then will be published anonymously for everyone to look at and to share. And that way, we already got thousands of people sharing the statistics of their hardware with the world. And that gives a very good independent overview of what are people using, what kind of hardware do people have. Also for developers, it's important to see what is currently in use, what do Blender users have. So yeah, the main thing for this year was after the code quest, everybody went home, and then development sinked down a little bit again, the speed. And not only because it's fun to have people together, the synergy is really important, but also because the money of the code quest was spent, and we could only pay the developers with the development fund. And this was the status at June 1 of the development fund, which is of course fantastic. We have so many people giving a regular contribution. But this whole total is a tiny bit low. I wouldn't say pathetic, but with the Blender community, with 1 million visitors every month, we could promote this better. This development fund was withering a little bit in a corner of the website. So we should give it more attention. And that's what we are currently doing. And we spent almost 2 months on fully redeveloping our system that gives a lot of added value for users. And that's the fund.blender.org development fund 2.0. So the campaign goal is to double or quadruple the amount of recurring donations. And it will help us to hire more full-time developers to work on Blender. My goal would be to get to the 50K per month, which then would be more than enough to have 10 people working on Blender full-time, plus some of the overhead, and including documentation, onboarding, and all the stuff what we need to do to get Blender stable and supported. As benefit of the development fund is a badge system, which we introduced last week. If you supported us with a rocket, we can get a little rocket badge if you post things on Blender forums, on Blender artists, or have you been working on the bug tracker and other Blender sites that shows what you have been contributing to Blender? You can get a development fund badge if you support us. There's also a corporate membership. So I'm experimenting with trying to get more studios or corporations on board who have a big interest in Blender. If you are a studio, and I've talked to studios like in France with 100 people, and they're all moving to Blender, they really need some support, or they want to know that they can keep using Blender. And if you look at what it would cost to have 100 Maya licenses running, that is 100 times 250, that's 25,000 per month goes like to some rich guy in America. Or you can say a little bit of that I will spend in the development fund, and then we can hire like half a developer or one developer full time on topics you find interesting. But to repeat, the focus is core Blender development. The development fund is not a magical feature request box. There's a lot of things that we have to do to keep Blender working. If you look at the thousands of features Blender has, I think half of them are probably not even in support currently. And that's frustrating. And we want to have a high quality tool, then we have to do all of the ugly job as well. So currently the development fund is doing really, really good. It runs less than a week. And this is from yesterday. It was going to 9,000 in recurring donations. So we're already over what the previous development fund had. And we are going to keep promoting it on the front page of Blender.org and everywhere to get people to subscribe. So also people who watch this video, there is no subscribe button, but you can go to fund.blender.org and join us. Now then, during the campaign in the past week, I had some questions, frequently asked questions even. What do people say? Yeah, hey, why can't we have like pay per feature, right? So then you pay some money for sculpting, or you pay some money for video editing, or for compositing, or all kinds of interesting things where you can put your money in. And you should listen more to users. Because there are so many users, and we have all so much to say. Why do you guys not listen more to users? Or I want really to define where my donation goes to. I put some money in, and I want to say where you have to spend it on. Or another one, popular, can we do voting for features? So all the people who are development fund members can get a voting right, and then you can have votes for things. So yeah, this is valid remarks. But these things are not easy to solve. And I will try to explain that. For example, what is a feature? So how does it work, a Blender feature? In some people's mind, a feature, Blender is like a vase with beautiful flowers. And every flower is a feature. And then you have those magical developers, and you kick them, or you seduce them, or do anything. And they pluck flowers in some magical gardens and put it in. And every flower is a beautiful feature. When a flower is going a bit old, you can replace it with another flower. So features are things you get, and they fall from the sky, or they are being made by people you don't know how they do it. From the developer's point of view, on the other hand, a feature is like a branch or a leaf on a tree. And Blender is 24 years old, right? It's a tree of 24 years old, with a big trunk and with roots. It's growing everywhere. It needs an ecosystem to run. It needs water, it needs nutrition. It has a stem, and it has branches and leaves. And sometimes it will make flowers in spring, and it gets new leaves, or the leaves fall. Sometimes a big branch breaks off, or gets cut off. And sometimes magically new branches appear, right? And those things take time. Right? That's a big branch, like on this tree, that could take like 10 years to really grow. Do people realize, for example, the cycles, which you could call a feature, is already 7 years old? Just 7 years of time has been people been working on cycles, and it's still not finished, right? So this stuff takes time. So what is then the development process? So imagine we are going to do a project, and we call it the Make Video Sequencer Great Again. Video Sequence Editor, great again, the MVSega. First step, get the funds, right? All the money. That's easy. Everybody is shipping in because we want to have a better video sequencer in Blender. Next problem is find a developer. Then you get the problem. Who knows how to code things for the video sequence editor? I don't know. If you know such a person who knows how to code things for the Blender Video Sequence Editor, please tell me, because we would like to know. But maybe you can find that person, or maybe you find a person who knows really well how video encoding works and video tools and has a good idea of, okay, I think I can pull it off. Well, good luck. But then you have to manage this, because the software development, and especially if you have a relationship from funding versus a developer, you need some kind of project structure, especially when it's bigger. Managing developers is hard. And you know all this famous cartoon of what people say, this is what the client wanted, and this is what in the end the company was delivering. Well, really, this happens. And even in my situation, or in my company, or in the Blender community, we often see that, okay, so we wanted this, and then we get that, right? And then we try to figure out how is it possible that we didn't have that communication working. You do your best, but it's not always working how you want it. But suppose this all goes fine. You have the new fantastic video sequencer. You've submitted as a batch to the Blender website, and then it needs to be reviewed. Because before big things get added to Blender, you get those number of developers with very strict review capacities. They're not always super nice, but they're very good, because they will only accept code in Blender when you can maintain it, when it fits the architecture. There's a lot of technical things that code has to comply to, even when, from a user point of view, it works. I love working code. I think it's super important. But it should also work next year, right? It should keep working, and it should be able to support it. So yeah, so if it, even when you have it approved and it gets added, the biggest issue is maintenance, support, fixing, upgrading it. Because does this video sequence developer, who did this great stuff and got his patch approved, does he stay on board? Is he going to maintain it? Did he make all the documents that we can understand it? Because, as usual, the last 10% of the work, what you think, the maintenance and the fixing and stuff, is often 90% of the work. So that's the whole complexity of development. So what do we do instead? For example, when people say we should listen more to users, I think it's a hard thing for me to define what it means. Users with a million visitors on the website every month, it's hard to listen to the noise. What I'd rather do is set up projects to work with users. There are a lot of users interested in joining projects we do, and they're all welcome. We have what we call module teams. You can find about that at wiki.blender.org, our technical documentation. You can find out how to get involved, because we want users on board to talk to developers and help them making better, more useful software. Then, do we have a democracy, or is Blender more like a meritocracy? The second meritocracy means that people get valued based on the contribution. And that also works for a volunteer-driven community project like Blender. If you're really good, if you contribute a lot, then why would we not empower that person also to decide on the area he's contributing to? But otherwise, it's not fun, right? You're not working for a boss. Most open source developers do things because they believe in it themselves. They think it's important to do this. So you have to enable and empower them to work. Well, the question, where does my money go? Well, we should communicate better, right? Like we did during the code quest, with vlogs, documentation, and don't forget onboarding. Onboarding is a popular term, but the Blender developers really fail at onboarding. That means new people should be easier to come on board, but the same is for users. If you want to become active, or you want to do something, documentation or whatever, it should be much smoother and easier to come on board. And we should not forget the volunteers in the community. It's not only about money. We have a lot of people who still contribute to Blender every day. And I want to thank all the volunteers. You know who you are, Blendify, Lazy Dodo, and all the others. I would like to have a big applause for all the volunteers. It's for everyone. But just to repeat, it's not core development. It means we work on what everyone's benefited. The development fund is going to work on the tree. We're going to make sure that this is a strong and big project that will keep surviving. I'm already over my time, so I'll quickly go to the final notes. Confidence notes. Yeah, bad. So yes, you have to wear it. And that's not only because I want to know who you are, because I want to talk to every Blender user, but I can't remember everybody's name all the time. The other thing is, it's also good for some kind of safety and security. Most people have bags and laptops and stuff, and we can all trust each other, but it's also good when you notice that everybody who is here has this. That means that you are one of the conference visitors. We have a one-way traffic rule in the theater. You get in there, and you get out there. And they even add a signs now. That's good. Entrance, exit. So this is because it's too crowded, but also to give people a fair chance between talks, that people go out and then new people can get in, that it rotates a little bit. We have a conference lunch this year, completely different. I want to see it myself, but there's going to be food served on four locations. One is a meat location with hamburgers. Nobody likes that. But if you want to eat some, you can go there. And then the three others are all vegetarian. And one, and even vegan. Because I really wanted to compensate this for once. I love vegetarian food as well, so don't mind. So that means there's salad, there's pastas, and there are sandwiches, and there are hamburgers. Something for everyone. It's freshly cooked. That also means that all of you cannot decide to get that hamburger or salad at 12 o'clock. Doesn't work. So don't worry if there is no food at 12. There is still food at 1, there's even food at 2, and we will keep cooking until everyone had their food. So don't all go at the same moment. If you see big lines, go to a talk and come back half an hour later. Tonight there are the Susanna screenings. We have two screenings, 7 and 9:30. They're the same screening, so you have to pick one, and then that's how everybody can watch it. And I can tell you, this year is going to be super special, with 3 premieres of things that have never been shown ever anywhere in the world. I cannot tell you what it is. You have to sit in the theater and make yourself surprised. Dinner tickets. So tomorrow we have a nightclub thing and a restaurant. This is a walking dinner. People also will get a green wristband if you want to have a vegetarian or vegan food. Then the people who walk around with food will give this to you to make sure this works fine. Tickets can be bought at the desk still. Now, and of course, apart from having lots of fun, I would like to thank the sponsors, Intel, Leonardo, Golem, Reply Protocube, Protocube Reply, and Render Street, and Sketchfab. Thank you. Have fun!